pleasure to introduce Ernesto Lupercio from Simvestab. He's going to talk us about non-commutative touring parades.
Well, I did know Samuel very well. He was one of my mentors, and teachers, and friends, and I miss him very much. And well, I'm therefore very happy to be here speaking in this small conference to his honor. Well, the first thing that I should say is that this is, in many ways, a continuation of the talk that Nikita gave earlier today. He delivered this beautiful talk where he produced this formula for pi as a summation over SL2Z. And he explained how he was motivated to obtain this formula by this sand piles that further motivate these piecewise linear functions and tropical geometry. And in this talk, we're going to talk about non-commutative geometry, toric geometry, non-commutative toric geometry, and finally some interesting relations to sand piles. In such a way that, although, just like in Nikita's talk, maybe the sand pile is not logically necessary to continue with the result, and even for the proofs or whatever, it is the sand pile that motivated the thinking behind some of the statements that I'm going to make. And since we have been playing with sand piles, this is not directly related to the talk today, but it's beautiful. And this we produce in the supercomputer Abacus with Aldo Guzman. And we have a family of these nice pictures. And we call them the Teotitlan fractals. And the people that have been to Teotitlan, Oaxaca, know what I'm talking about. And if you haven't been to Teotitlan, Oaxaca, just go there so that you know what I'm talking about. And it's kind of a nice picture, you know. And but there is an aspect that you can see in this picture definitely that Nikita was talking about, and it's the fact that you can see here these tropical curves in the middle of this fractal or sand pile thing. And this will be relevant later on today, but I just wanted to show the picture because it's beautiful. And now I start with my talk. So, I close this thing up. And, all stories are just one story. And I'm really going to tell a story. This is not, again, very much on Nikita's cue. I'm not really going to give a mathematics talk, but I'm going to tell you a story, a mathematical story. And all the stories are only one story, but we have to choose a beginning, and we're going to choose 1925 as the beginning of our story. Because in 1925, it was the year in which there was the famous publication of the legendary paper on quantum mechanics. By Born and Jordan, and that's how this guy got his Nobel Prize, and also the publication of the no less legendary paper on quantum mechanics too. And now there is the addition of Born, Heisenberg, guy, you know, and Jordan. And
this guy is Born, right?
Huh?
Who is this guy? You think about this guy? Got the Nobel Prize.
Well, this guy got the Nobel Prize, and this guy got the Nobel Prize. More or less for this paper, this guy got the Nobel Prize, and more or less for this paper, this guy got the Nobel Prize. Of course, there have been many more things in the citation and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
The,
and the other guy could have got the Nobel Prize if he weren't
a
NASA.
Details, but anyway. But let's not get into that right now. Anyway, so these were legendary papers, and it's in this paper that you can read for the very first time, these papers, maybe this one, I don't know, this equation. And so this equation is going to be very important to us. But let's see how you could get to that equation from what they had in their hands. They had some experimental observations, and then how do you go from these experimental observations to this equation? Well, let's see, what did they have as an experimental observation? Well, what they had were these spectra. So you had these atoms, for example, the hydrogen atom, or more complicated atoms, and then you would get this spectra, emission spectra for the atoms, and they would have these lines at different wavelengths. They would have these lines, and these were some numbers, a collection of numbers, the wavelengths of the spectra. And now you have a collection of numbers, and now you can measure these numbers with enormous precision, thanks to the most recent developments in the experimental measurement of this spectra at the time. Now you have these numbers with enormous precision, and you want to make sense of them. That's what they have. So already Balmer in 1885, notice, well, you see these numbers and you start playing with them. So 1885, this is before, of course. Notice that from 1885 to 1925 is like 30 years. And then Balmer, notice in 1885 that what you could say about those numbers, at least for the hydrogen atom, is that lambda was of the form, these wavelengths, centimeters. So he already noticed this, and already this was extremely puzzling. You never know, you know, as Nikita said, you put these numbers on the computer and tells you it's like these things, you know. But he didn't notice that all these numbers were of the form, they were parameterized by integers. This is very puzzling to begin with. And the specific formula for the integers is also very puzzling to begin with, but it's something to start. From this, and looking at more complicated atoms, in 1890, Rydberg, also Nobel Prize. So now we are in 1890, a little while later. And so, for more complicated atoms, more generally, you needed two integers. M is fixed. So it depends on the atom, so to speak. M is the atom, and then there is all this other integer. And then R is 4 over L, the Rydberg constant. And then, of course, this motivates you to change a parameter from the wavelength to the frequency. And this is a more sophisticated, but it's the same spirit. You have these integers, quadratic, and the lines in the spectra of these atoms are parameterized by these integers, and this is very puzzling. And what do you do with this? Because you see, if you use classical mechanics, the whole thing doesn't make sense. In classical mechanics, you have a space-time that is a continuum, and you have coordinates that commute with each other. And if you take classical mechanics plus the Maxwell equations, what you conclude is that the spectrum should be an additive group. An additive group. This is not an additive subgroup of the real numbers. So the spectrum has to be an additive subgroup. It's gotta be an additive subgroup. And the observables, it's easy to see, should be the convolution algebra. The convolution algebra of gamma. But gamma is a commutative group because it's a subgroup of the real numbers. And the convolution algebra is a commutative algebra. So the algebra of observables, where you have the Poisson bracket that does all your mechanics, corresponds to the convolution algebra of your spectrum, that is a subgroup of the real numbers. And everything is commutative. But that's not what you see. What you see is this. That is not that at all. So what led by the beautiful ideas of Born and Jordan, Heisenberg made a remarkable proposal. And we can interpret this proposal in the following way. Now, this is not exactly how Heisenberg did it, but it's very close to exactly what Heisenberg did. And it's the following. The first thing that you observe is that there is the Rydberg-Ritz combination formula. That it says that something remarkable is that once you change parameter to nu, once you change parameter from the confusing parameter lambda wavelength to the much better parameter nu frequency, then some of the frequencies add to some of the other. But it's not a group, because one frequency have to ask, so there is these secret numbers that you don't see. What you see are these things. You see these things, you don't see these things. But they exist. These numbers exist. You don't see them, but well, you can compute these numbers. These numbers exist. And this number has to ask to this one. Can I add with you? So these J's have to coincide so that these two frequencies really add up to one the other frequency. So you cannot always, so it's not a group, you cannot always add them. It's a groupoid. One of the things has to ask the other, can I combine with you? Yes, then it's the frequency eats in the spectrum. So you have a partial operation. This set has a partial operation. And now, in a little bit more modern language, you can think of a category. And what is this category? Well, you index these things, you compute these gammas, you index these things, and you call the abstract set of indices I. You call this abstract set of indices I. It's just an abstract set. And the objects of this category are I. And the arrows from I to J, it's simply a pair I, J. The arrows are in correspondence with I cross I. So mathematicians like writing this in this fashion. And this is a groupoid. It's not a group because you cannot always combine two things. But if J coincides with J, if the second coincides with the first, then you can combine them. And the combination rule is IJ composed with JK is IK. And so this forms a category. Well, you can do a little bit better than a category, and you need to do a little bit better. You have to declare that IJ inverse is JI. And once this category is actually a groupoid. So let's call this groupoid the Heisenberg groupoid. So let's call this groupoid the Heisenberg groupoid. Because I just said, in classical mechanics, the observables corresponded to the convolution algebra of the group. And Heisenberg's proposal is that the observables in quantum theory correspond to the convolution algebra of the groupoid. And let me just call it like this, the convolution algebra of the groupoid. Let me just use this symbol to denote the convolution algebra of the groupoid. So in this case, this is exactly the matrix algebra. And once you accept that the observable are matrices, you write your equations like you used to do it, just the same that you used to do. So, for example, your evolution becomes this. That is a linear evolution. And of course, your equation becomes this. And if you do the exercise now, I mean, etc., etc., if you do the exercise, you rapidly get to all the conclusions in the Max, in the Born, Heisenberg, Jordan paper. So, once you accept that it's not a group, but a groupoid, and that the observables are not the convolution algebra of a group, but the non-commutative convolution algebra of a groupoid, then you recover the Born, Heisenberg, Jordan proposal. And then you get two Nobel Prizes or something. So non-commutative geometry is about this. In space usually have coordinates that commute, and symmetries are given by groups. But now, in non-commutative geometry, coordinates do not commute, and we're going to consider very soon this equation as extremely important for us. And not only coordinates do not commute, but symmetries are to be thought of as groupoids rather than as groups. So that's what non-commutative geometry is about. So let me just say it again. In non-commutative geometry, in NC geometry, and this is the vision advocated and the narrative, the philosophy of Alan Kohn. That explains all these things in greater length in his book, Non-Commutative Geometry. Well, traditionally you have a space. And you have a space in function of the space, and this is commutative. It's a commutative algebra. In such a way that in the reverse direction, you can sort of go back taking some sort of spectrum, I just explained. The convolution, so the spectrum of these operators will give you the space. So, in algebraic geometry, you take these maximal ideals, it's all the same basic procedure. So from spaces, you go to commutative algebras, from commutative algebras, you go to spaces. In non-commutative geometry, where you want to have a non-commutative algebra, and here you have something, and I will just use calligraphic letters to denote that the space is non-commutative. And so there is this notion of spec, not very well defined, but there is a lot of technology to think about these things. Okay, so that's non-commutative geometry. But the way we are going to use non-commutative geometry is through the theory of foliations. So let me remind you what is a foliation. Well, a book is foliated by its leaves. So you think of a book, and a book is the union of its leaves. In the same manner, a manifold, it's if you make it the union of many other manifolds, all of them disjoints, well, let me call them L, so that they are leaves. So if you have here, I don't know, a manifold, for example, a disk, and you have all concentric circles, well, there's a problem, so I'm going to take the disk minus the origin. It's the union of many circles of different radii. And the disjoint union, less than one, less than or equal to one, I don't know. And this is a foliation of the disk without a point. That is the same as a cylinder. That's a foliation of the cylinder. And there is, so you have a manifold divided in this fashion into many manifolds of the same dimension, and it's a lower dimension, obviously, that the dimension of L, then you have the manifold foliated. So it's a foliation. So we are going to use an important foliation for us, very important, that is the Kronecker foliation. The Kronecker foliation. So what is the Kronecker foliation? Well, what you do is, you remember that a torus can be obtained from the plane R2, and you take this kind of divide into squares, the plane R2, and you take the quotient of the action of R2 acted on by the integer lattice. And all this means is that you're going to define xy with x plus n comma y plus m for n and m integers. And so you obtain the torus. And now what you're going to do is you're going to consider all lines, all parallel lines with certain slope. So you consider all parallel lines with certain slope, what I'm going to call theta slope, and you see what happens here. So it is an interesting thing to think about if you have never thought about it, because if theta is a rational slope, say 2/3 or whatever, then if you take one of these lines, only one of these lines, and see what happens here, well, what you get is a so-called torus knot that goes, say, if the slope is p over q, it goes p times around like this and q times around like that. And it's just the torus knot p comma q. It's the torus knot p comma q. And if you take a transversal to this foliation, well, what you see at the level of the transversal is that you hit it once, you hit it twice, maybe you hit it, and then you return. After a certain number of integer times, when you are going around this knot, you hit it, you hit it, you hit it, and then you return. So all this is codified in a rotation of the circle that I'm going to call rotate. The foliation of the torus into torus knots is entirely codified on a rotation of the circle. But of course, the situation is far more interesting in the case in which the slope is not rational. Because think about it. If the slope is not rational, then you constantly keep missing yourself. So green is not rational. And then you go here, and then you go here, and then you go here, and then you... But when you were about to go back, after many, many times, you barely miss yourself. And then you keep going, and going, and going, and going, and going, and going, and you never hit yourself because the number was irrational. And it's almost the definition of irrational that you never return to yourself. And so what you obtain is a foliation of the torus, but now every leaf is contractible, it's a real line, every leaf, and every leaf is dense. So you have the property that every leaf gives you the full torus. The closure of every leaf is the full torus. Of course, every leaf is of measure zero, I mean, that's still true. It's infinitely unlikely that you're going to hit one of these leaves, but every single leaf is dense everywhere. And while in the rational case, the quotient of this torus by this torus knot, the quotient space is just a circle. Here the quotient space is just a circle. When you are in the irrational case, the quotient space is all Hausdorff and not a manifold, and it looks very bad from the topological point of view. So say you want to study the quotient space, and this is called, or I'm going to call it today, a foliation. I'm going to use this F to indicate that M is foliated. And the quotient space is take the whole leaf and make it a point. That's the quotient space. And I'm going to represent that by M mod F. In the case, in the rational case, the quotient space is a circle. So there is two possibilities. A circle when the slope is rational, and some crazy thing, when the slope is irrational. So, but say you wanted to study the quotient space with the tools of differential geometry, like differential forms and all these sort of things. Well, this looks very bad, this doesn't look so bad, this looks very bad. What do you do? Well, Alan Cohn provided an answer. The natural way to think about this quotient space, and even this, of course, but this quotient space is a non-commutative space. And in fact, the following is an observation of Alan Cohn, or theorem, or but very important for us, very, very important. And it's the following statement. So I told you that what characterizes a non-commutative space is its non-commutative algebra of observables. And for the Kronecker foliation, the algebra what do you do? For any foliation, for that matter. For the Kronecker foliation, you construct a groupoid that, as its objects, has the points of the torus. Every point in the torus is an object of this groupoid, and two points are connected by an arrow, if and only if they are in the same leaf. And the arrows are given by leaves. So the leaves of the foliation produce the categorical structure of the groupoid. And then Alan Cohn teaches us that the convolution algebra of this groupoid is generated by two letters that don't commute, and is the exponential Heisenberg, Born Heisenberg Jordan relation. So maybe I should have called them P and Q. But let me just think that E is E to the 2 pi I P, and Y is E to the 2 pi I Q. In such a way that to have this foliation is the same as having as the Born-Heisenberg-Jordan relations. So the Born-Heisenberg-Jordan relations from quantum mechanics have a geometric avatar, a geometric existence in a foliation, in the Kronecker foliation. And so this particular non-commutative space that has this algebra of observables, this quantum system that has this algebra of observables, is called the non-commutative torus. And so it may be confusing because I had this torus here, and this is not the torus that is in the non-commutative torus. The non-commutative torus, it's called like that because, well, it has two circular variables, and in an ordinary torus, two circular variables would commute, and these ones don't commute. They don't commute by very little. There is this thing with the h bar that is to be thought as very small, and so you have the non-commutative torus. And the non-commutative torus, what Alan Cohn discovered, is that it has a geometric avatar in the Kronecker foliation. And that's very important for us. So, enough about thorae, but not quite. So let me switch subjects rather drastically for a second into the realm of toric geometry. Because I want to speak about non-commutative toric varieties. First, I have to tell you what is a non-commutative space. And I really have to tell you what is a non-commutative torus. But now I want to tell you what is a toric variety to finally tell you what is a non-commutative toric variety. And toric varieties already appeared, of course, in the talk of Vladimir, that he explained very well on this story, but let me just say it very briefly again. So, Vladimir explained how, what a toric variety, but let me say it. Let me describe the situation. So here is a toric variety. So what is a toric variety? Well, a toric variety is an equivariant compactification of a complex torus. So I have to tell you what is a complex torus. So what is a real torus? Well, the two torus, notice that the two torus, the one you know, is S1 cross S1. So it's very natural to define the real torus as n copies of S1 multiplied. So then S1 cross S1 cross S1 cross S1. And so that the one torus, the real one torus, is just a circle. Now, the real one complex torus is going to be C minus 0, that I'm going to denote by C star. That contains S1, namely the one complex torus, contains the one real torus. And they are homotopy equivalent. And likewise, then it's natural to define the n complex torus as C star cross C star. And it is an easy exercise that this is an affine algebraic variety. So what is a toric variety? A toric variety is one that contains densely, completely densely, the complex torus. So it contains a complex torus, but it's closure. It's a closure, it's an equivariant closure of the complex torus. And then, you see the real torus is inside here. And since this closure, this algebraic closure is equivariant, this complex torus acts here. Moreover, this is not only a variety, it's really a Kähler manifold. So that it has a symplectic structure, a metric, and a complex structure. It is a Kähler manifold. It has a real torus, and the real torus acts by Hamiltonian vector fields. It's a Hamiltonian action. So the infinitesimal action of the real torus is Hamiltonian. And so you wonder what are its momenta. So the situation is as follows. You have the so-called moment map that goes to the dual of the Lie algebra of this group.
and that's just Rn.
So it's a map to Rn.
And it is a beautiful, very beautiful theorem of many people, but Del Sand, you can also mention Gilliam and Sternberg, but yeah, I don't know the chronological order, but certainly the name of Del Sand should be said. That the image of this moment map, that it is convex, is a very general result of Atiyah and Gilliam and Sternberg. So the image of the moment map is a convex set. But in this case, it's much better than that. It is a convex polytope. A convex polytope. And if I take a little point in this polytope, and I look at what the inverse image, it is a torus, a real torus of some dimension. What dimension? Even that is nice. If I have the polytope, the dimension has to do with in what stratum of the polytope you are. So, let me give you an example. Take the one complex torus, that is to say C star, and the obvious compactification is B1. So that's a toric variety. So I have this toric variety that is P1, that is just a two sphere. And then you have the moment map. And the moment map is just the height function. The image of the moment map is this interval. That's the image of the moment map. So this is P. And if I take a point and I look at its inverse image, well, I get a one real torus here. And as I change the strata, the dimension of the torus changes. If I change the strata, the dimension of the torus changes. So this is the moment map for this toric variety. Let's complicate just a tad little bit the situation. And let's do a second and a third example. Example dos. Now take D to C, that is C star cross C star. Well, I can put it inside P1 cross P1. I know it's kind of cheap, but I can do it. It's a compactification. And then, well, P1 cross P1 looks something like this, depending on the radius of the symplectic form, you know, of the radius of the two spheres. It's like a little sphere at every point of a sphere. And then, if this sphere is thin, this is not so long, and then this is long, and this is not so long, and this rectangle is the image of the moment map. This rectangle is the image of the moment map. Of course, this is inside R2. This rectangle is the image of the moment map. So, to this polytope, to this rectangle, it corresponds P1 cross P1 with this radius. And as I change the shape of the rectangle, the radius of these two spheres changes. But it's still P1 cross P1 topologically, and even as complex manifolds, but as symplectic manifolds, they are different when I change the shape of the rectangle. Well, let me do one third example. One third example is the following one, that is, now I'm going to do D2C again, but I'm going to put it inside P2. I'm going to put it inside P2. And now here it is P2, and the image of the moment map is like this. And the inverse image at this point is a point. The inverse image at this point is a circle in such a way that the inverse image of this segment looks just like this. The inverse image of this segment is just a little sphere. The inverse image of this segment is this little sphere. The inverse image of this center is this little sphere inside here. And then the inverse image at a particular point here is a torus. A two torus, a real two torus, and so on. In such a way that you reconstruct P2 from the combinatorics and put in tori at the different points of the polytope. And then you reconstruct the manifold that way. I should mention a fact that was very much used in Vladimir's talk. That is, well, now I have these pictures that represent some algebraic varieties. For every one of these polygons, even, I have one of these algebraic varieties. Is there any restriction on the polytopes or polygons that I get? Yes. It's very important that these slopes are rational. And when I think them together with the embedding, it's very important that these slopes are rational. Very important. Rational. And of course you start salivating when you hear that, you know? Because now everything starts to make sense. So these slopes have to be rational. And another thing that Vladimir said that's very important is that if I chop off one of these things and I modify a polygon into another by brutally chopping off one of the corners, then what I did in algebraic geometry is I did a blow up. So chopping off a corner, it's a nice exercise, corresponds to a blow up. And that's all we really need to know about toric geometry to continue. So these pictures correspond to algebraic varieties that can be assembled putting tori of different dimension at the different strata, and they form an algebraic variety, and chopping off a corner means to do a blow up. Okay, that being said, now I can state the first theorem, and different polytopes correspond to different manifolds. And the combinatorics of the polytope kind of determines the manifold more or less up to diffeomorphism, and that kind of thing. But the exact shape determines the symplectic form. The exact shape of the polytope determines the symplectic form. And now we have a theorem of Donald Merzeman, Alberto Verkhovsky. So what is the theory? And then this is Merzeman, Verkhovsky, Katsarkov, and myself. And so we have developed a theory of non-commutative toric varieties. How does this theory look? It looks like follows. What is a non-commutative toric variety? Well, a non-commutative toric variety is an equivariant compactification of a non-commutative complex torus. Of course, I'm being terribly unfair, because I should tell you what it means for a non-commutative space to compactify another non-commutative space. I should tell you what it means for a non-commutative space to be complex. I should tell you what it means for a non-commutative space to be Kähler. But luckily, I don't have time. So it's an equivariant compactification of a non-commutative complex torus. And we have developed, and together with Enrique Becerra, a machinery to be able to speak, to make sense of this sentence. But it makes sense. And then, once you have this then we proved a theorem in this theory. It's an important theorem for our theory. And they are symplectic. They have Hamiltonian actions on a non-commutative space, how do you say that? It has a moment map. It does have a moment map. The image of the moment map still falls inside RL and still is a polytope with the same combinatorial restrictions, but say no to Q. Now every slope appears, no longer rational slopes. In fact, the toric variety is commutative, is ordinary, is the old good old friend of yours, if and only if the polytope is rational. And as soon as just one of the slopes is irrational, then it's a non-commutative toric variety. So this polytope, no longer rational, is the image of the moment map. Inside, densely, is a non-commutative torus. But moreover, if I take an arbitrary point here, the inverse image is a non-commutative real torus of the correct dimension that is embedded into your non-commutative. And this is exactly the Heisenberg, the Born-Heisenberg-Jordan exponential non-commutative relations. And you can reconstruct the sister algebra of the whole non-commutative toric variety, or you can glue a lot of sister algebras that look like the Heisenberg, like the Born-Heisenberg-Jordan sister algebras, according to the combinatorics of the polytope. And we have done it, we know, we can do it. Okay. But of course, a sister algebra, a non-commutative algebra, what I mean by sister is non-commutative algebra, is not sufficient to describe the Kähler geometry of this X, nor its symplectic structure. We need to say more, and we have said more. So, that's a non-commutative toric variety. And now, let me just say a couple of words about what they are good for, and how with Nikita and Mikhail Shkolnikov we can generalize further this situation to an even more ambitious setting, using, not using, but inspired by Nikita's sandpiles. So, it's good that you went to his talk, because I'm just going to assume that you know his stuff that he said in his last talk. But let me just say what these things are good for. First, they give a very neat, very clean, very simple, I don't know, a very clean solution to the McMullen conjecture. So, McMullen asks, if you have one of these, the combinatorial restriction, I never mentioned the combinatorial restriction, is the same for the commutative case as it is for the non-commutative case. And it just means that the dual of this polytope is a triangulation of the sphere. That's the combinatorial restriction, that's all. The dual of this polytope is a triangulation of the sphere. So if I write the dual, you immediately know that it is a triangulation of the sphere. It's a triangulation of the sphere, okay. The McMillan conjecture said, if you have one of these P's, so that the dual of the polytope is a triangulation of the sphere, you get one of these combinatorial pieces, one of the just combinatorics. But you know that it can be realized. You know that you can put it inside some array. And you form the F vector. The F vector is you take the number of vertices, the number of edges, the number of faces, the number, and you form a vector until you finish. So you take the F vector. And the question that McMullen posed, well, attacked, is can you give a combinatorial equations, integral equations, that the solutions of those equations are exactly these vectors? So can you write equations so that the solutions, the Diophantine solutions of these equations are exactly these vectors? Even better if the coefficients of the equations are integer. And but he not only asked the question, he wrote the equations. They are fantastic. These extremely elaborate equations, whose solutions are exactly the vectors that appear like this. Okay. But he couldn't prove it. He said he was a great combinatorialist, but he couldn't prove it, so he conjectured this was so. And then Richard Stanley had a brilliant idea. He realized that he could do it for Q, in the case that P was realized here with rational slopes. How? Well, he took the toric variety associated to the polytope and proved in a beautiful argument that these tremendous equations were equivalent to the Haar-Lipschitz theorem.
Lefschetz being one of the direct teachers of Sam, it's very appropriate today. So this was, these equations were equivalent to the Hart-Lefschetz theorem, and then the theorem is true, because the Hart-Lefschetz theorem is true. So that was a brilliant argument. The only detail is that it only works for rational polytopes. But now you don't have that problem. Let me say that our proof is not the first proof of the McMillan conjecture. Combinatorialists even managed to prove it by combinatorial methods. There is 3-4 proofs of the McMillan conjecture. But now Alberto, Laurent, Ludmila and I have another one, a new one. What is this new one? Well, the Hart-Lefschetz theorem is true also in these non-commutative Kähler manifolds. Now, we do not prove in general the Hart-Lefschetz theorem for all non-commutative Kähler manifolds. We prove it for a small enough family in which these ones fall. And we use our proof is not very hard because we use results of Paul Bresler that do the harder part. So Paul Bresler has this very nice thing, and we more or less use it to prove that the Hart-Lefschetz theorem is true in this situation. And then from the Hart-Lefschetz theorem, you can deduce the McMillan conjecture. Paul Bresler deduced it only algebraically from his same results. So it's not really different from Paul Bresler's proof, but it's conceptually coherent in the philosophy of non-commutative geometry. So, using Paul Bresler, we can prove the Hart-Lefschetz theorem. We can do this curly. And now, we can prove this, but now we don't have the rational restriction. Now it's every polytope like that, like in the original McMillan conjecture. So you get a proof of the McMillan conjecture, using, of course, Paul Bresler, and using the idea of Richard Stanley. So, they can be used for something. So they are not just completely philosophical objects. Nothing wrong with that, but they can be used for something. But there's another thing that you can do. And this is very miraculous, and it's very reminiscent of Twister theory. That is, now you can do the modular space. So there is a, fortunately, in our team, we, as Nikita said, we like doing social mathematics. So we have for every problem, we have a collaborator who can do it. And hopefully, in our team, we have Laurent, that is a super expert in deformation theory. And he has developed his own huge machinery of deformation theory. And it beautifully does the job in this case. And then you can produce the modular space of non-commutative Tory varieties. So, the modular space of non-commutative Tory varieties is meant to be a space that is the set of all non-commutative Tory varieties. It's the set of all non-commutative, but it has geometry. And the theorem that we have managed to set with the enormous expertise of Laurent Merceman is that M is a complex orthos. If you don't know what the word orthos means, ignore it and say manifolds. M is a complex manifold. So, and this is miraculous because you see, at first you would think, what's going on? You know, all you are doing is deforming polytopes or polygons. Why does it have a complex structure? But of course, we have the great Santiago Lopez de Medrano that gave us the clue, the Gale transform. The Gale transform gives you the complex structure in the modular space of non-commutative toric varieties. So thank you, Santiago. That part is really a great remark, that this is important. And in our language, when he proposed the Gale transform was for slightly different uses, but in our language, what it means is that this is a complex manifold. And this complex structure is really miraculous. So you can do the modular space. A technical remark is that you have to do, if you try just to do the modular space, you have these problems like with Hopf surfaces and all these classical problems that look very, very confusing. But in this case, there is a very beautiful trick that the physicist
thank you, physicist. Like Google, you know, taught us that is you turn on the B field. And if you turn on the B field, then the modular space works beautifully. So we turn on the B field, and then we have a beautiful modular space. Just like in string theory. So we just turn on the B field. And let me just finish with the work in progress with Shkolnikov and Nikita. And he already told you most of it in his talk, but let me just very quickly say the implications of these ideas for the theory of non-commutative toric varieties. And this has to do with sampires. So, in Nikita's talk, Atiyah Guillemin Sternberg. Atiyah Guillemin Sternberg proved that under certain conditions, if you have a symplectic manifold and a Hamiltonian action, the image of the moment map is a convex set. That's a theorem of Atiyah Guillemin Sternberg. And so our work in progress theorem, and this is Nikita Kalinin, Mikhail Shkolnikov, and we are proving that the converse is true for every, almost every, very few exceptions. Convex set in Rn, convex, there exists, but it's much better than the converse, a non-commutative toric space, X, the image of whose moment map is Z. So, of course, you want to prove the converse. You have any convex set. You see, the converse is true. I mean, look at the idea of Richard Stanley in combinatorics. He had a convex set, and then he said, well, instead of studying the convex set, I'm going to study the toric variety that produces that convex set. Well, now every convex set admits a non-commutative toric space, and the image. And sampires produce this X. Or, well, ideas from sampires produce this X. These sampires produce this X. Let me just say very briefly the very basic idea, and then I finish, because my time is over. Long time ago. The very basic idea is to look at what Nikita did last talk. Take a convex set, and then you get this kind of Palacio de los Deportes structure on top of the convex set. You saw, you remember the picture, this Palacio de los Deportes structure on top of the convex set. And this gives you a canonical family of toric varieties approximating more and more the convex set. And now I don't have time to explain this, I could explain a little bit better, but as they approximate this convex set, they become ever more slightly non-commutative. Because what is going on at the level of the torus is that you have a torus node PQ, but Q is growing and growing and growing. So in the limit is a non-commutative torus because you think of it as a foliation. And I'm not going to say more, but you can ask me questions. Thank you very much.
Questions?
I think that it would be nice to remember that Fiametta Battaglia and Elisa Prato also play a role in this.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry for...
I think we didn't mention...
Yeah. I'm very sorry. I keep missing
them. I just met them in Florence. Yeah.
And they are extremely important for
this story. I told them that would be correct.
Yeah. I mean, they are extremely important for this story.
Another thing that... is the set of extreme points in this beautiful result, any convex set, for the sphere or the ellipsoid, but is there a restriction in the extreme points of the convex set? No.
I mean,
you cannot do these infinite strips or something like that, but as, for example, compact any convex set,
okay,
in any dimension.
Uh-huh. Yeah, compact, but the structure of the boundary is arbitrary.
Yes.
Non-smooth, nothing.
Frankly, I don't think there is an obstruction there, but...
Yeah, because the approximation that works for...
Yeah.
That...
Yeah.
Is the Felix Candela approximation.
The
you know who's Felix Candela?
The guy who built the stadium.
He's the great architect,
oh, yeah,
Spanish refugee who made that beautiful.
Well, I would call it
the Candela Sandpipe.
That sounds nice, you know. Your name for an architect is fantastic. But yeah, that sounds like a nice idea. But it's really what Nikita was explaining in his last talk, with which he obtained this amazing formula for pi. You missed the talk, right?
I missed it because I just came from.
Uh-huh.
But what's film?
It's going to be on YouTube or something.
Well, I was of course curious to see some examples of non-Hilbertian varieties. So a question that I have about possible examples. So things that various people call sort of non-commutative PNs, which of them are non-commutatoric varieties in your sense? For example, if we are talking, I don't know, about Sclannian algebras or things like that.
We can do all that. All of them.
For example, indeed, if
we have the modular space of non-commutative PNs.
If you take Sclannian algebra corresponding to a point on the elliptic curve, what is the polytop corresponding to that?
That I don't know. And it's a nice question and we should talk. But of course, I mean, we used this in summer and managed to kind of get our hands dirty. And so it's kind of a new stuff, you know. But there is lots of questions like that.
When are you going to give a talk about your work with Penrose?
Yeah, well, there is a branch of this work that it's a collaboration with Roger Penrose. But that's a little bit on a slightly more primitive state, because we need to do this for the hyperkähler case. And so it's a bit harder, but once you do it for the hyperkähler case, it gives you a handle on non-commutative twister space and modulo difficulties on top of difficulties over Palaszczuk twister theory. The basic idea, though I can say a word about the basic idea. The basic idea is that in space-time, you have an event. It can be identified by all the light rays that touch that event. And then you can do projective duality and think of an event as some sort, well, this is R 3,1 or 1,3, and then you can think of an event, and it's extremely important that this is four-dimensional. It's extremely important that this is four-dimensional. It just doesn't work so well in any other dimension. And so you have a P 3, but you would want these events to be, you would want to quantize gravity, so you need these events to be fuzzy. And so it's kind of hard to tell what is a fuzzy point. But under twister Penrose duality, it's not so bad to write here kind of a non-commutative P3. And we have families of non-commutative P3s and the modular space of non-commutative P3s. So now we can geometrize, we can do non-commutative, very basic twister space. Then we have to shiftify it. We have to shiftify it to get the whole thing going. But even at this very primitive stage, what you get is Penrose's deformation of, say, the Einstein's equations of gravitation, including h bar. And so, with this geometry, we are attempting, with a certain level of success, to deform gravity to include h bar. So that's the basic idea. But it's very important that it's not the symplectic form that I was talking about in this talk. It's a different symplectic form, and to reach that symplectic form, we need the hyperkähler structure. But we'll talk more about it. You are more hyperkähler.
Other questions? Well, we think the speaker